I think this morning will be sort of interesting to you. I really do. We're going back in our Bibles, and we'd like for you to turn your Bibles clear back to the first book, and that is Genesis. The first book of the Bible, Genesis. And I'd like for you to go to Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. We come back here, and we're going to give you a little bit. It'll be sort of interesting to you, I believe. That, you know, when we talk about the flood and being on the earth here and so forth like that, destroying every human being except Noah and eight people, including him, and so forth. And then they say, oh, you know, how about the boat? And was it big enough? And so forth like that. And anyway, we thought we'd give you some facts about that. And let you know how stupid humanity is and how smart Christians are. And why God wrote it and put all the details in the Bible to let you know, yeah, the boat's big enough, folks. It's plenty big enough. So anyway, we're going back here, and we're going to find out that God had given to Noah in order to do this. So I'd like for you to go here in chapter 6, all right? In chapter 6, we find out, first of all, why God did this. And it's unbelievable that in 1656 years, and where we get that, just real fast, if you trace the genealogies from Adam and Eve, clear on up there, to the flood, you come to 1,056 years. Well, you find out that the flood came in the 600th year of Noah, which would mean it was 1,656 years when the flood came. That's a long time, isn't it, for man to be on the earth. But man had completely disintegrated himself and herself by worshiping everything except God. And it became so bad that even we find out that there was a man by the name of Enoch who was living prior to Noah's time, and he preached that there was a judgment coming because of you wicked people. God had created from Adam and Eve, started out on the wrong foot, Cain and Abel. Abel offered a blood sacrifice because Adam and Eve had fig leaves covered themselves. In other words, a picture of what they did for themselves to cover their sin. God rejected that. He slew the animal and clothed them with the skins of the animal, showing the blood had to be shed is the only remission for sins, pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ when he would come and die upon the cross. All of this was a type. Runs all through the Bible. So anyway, they didn't want anything to do with that. So Cain and Abel, you find out that Cain was of that wicked one, we find out in the New Testament, because Satan loves to tell you that you're going to heaven by good works. You just be the best you can, and God would not think of sending you to hell. That's a lie out of hell, and Satan is a murderer and a liar. So if you believe his lie, he will kill you by putting you in the lake of fire instead of you going to heaven. Isn't that interesting? Mm-hmm. Very simple. That truth runs all the way through the Bible, clear down through there up 4,000 years to the cross of Christ and another 2,000 years to where you are right here in Walnut Grove. Right here. You'll take Catholicism. You'll take Lutheranism. You will take your Church of Christ, and so forth. Either it's baptism or good works. And that's exactly what these cult religions teach. Half of the Bible Luther never believed, but he said, and if you doubt it, I will bring his catechism and read it to you. Baptism forgives your sins. It also makes you a child of God, and so forth, and gives you eternal life. That's exactly what Martin Luther believed, and the man is in hell today by promoting exactly what Roman Catholicism says. And he didn't come out of Roman Catholicism, he was kicked out of the church because he believed that the priests could forgive your sins, but he didn't believe they should charge for it. Isn't that something? That's the truth about where you're living in this area right here today. Going to have good works. We find out that's not true. But if you don't have good works, then you know there's a first mentioned principle. Wherever you find it in the Bible, it'll carry that truth all the way through the Bible, clear to the end of the book of Revelation. You'll find out that when Abel offered the blood sacrifice, God accepted his sacrifice because it was a blood sacrifice which God was using as a down payment, showing it is a type of what's going to happen in the future when Jesus Christ comes to this earth and sheds his blood on the cross of Calvary. Without the shedding of blood, in Hebrews chapter 9, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Cain offered the best that he could produce, and he offered the fruit of the ground. He grew some wonderful things, didn't describe exactly what they were, but they were beautiful. He offered them to God for his eternal life. God said, I set them at his doorstep. In other words, Cain, you're trying by your own self-righteousness to con me into giving you entrance into heaven, which I totally reject, because you denied the blood sacrifice, you were self-righteous, and you thought that I could not turn down your beautiful offering that you did because of your self-righteousness. Do you know what happened? And you have the same thing today. Same thing. Cain became so infuriated that he sought and he killed Abel because he couldn't stand that. You're in an area right here where when we preach the gospel and there that the only way to heaven is, so straight and narrow is the way, the straight and narrow is you go straight to Jesus Christ and the cross. Period. Nothing else. Nothing else is added to it in any way, shape, or form. He will not accept anything else that you mix with it. If you mix something with it, it cancels salvation. For by grace are you saved, through faith, that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. The gift of God is bought and paid for, is it not? Sure, it sure is. Thank God that he bought and paid. Your ticket to heaven is already purchased. It was purchased by the death and resurrection of Christ on the cross. And he offers it to all mankind until you get religions. Religions are made up of men who inject their ideologies, they add to the Word of God, they take away the Word of God, and they do everything under the world to make you feel religious. Mm-hmm. Now, we have some friends who we do not cut them slack in any way, that when they come and it comes Ash Wednesday, the preacher takes his finger into the palm leaves that were burnt last year, and if you go along with what they teach, then you step forward and he'll take and his finger and put them in the ashes and put them on your forehead, and you'll leave them there through Easter. Well, some said, you know what, it's pretty hard when I go up, you know, to Walmart and some of these other places that you know, to keep that on there, because they're always asking, well, what do you get something on your forehead? You know, there isn't one thing in the Bible about a Good Friday, about Ash Wednesday. It never existed in the Bible. You search the Bible through. This was put in religion to make you feel like, oh, you're doing something for God. You're declaring how much your faith is. It's a bunch of garbage. There's nothing in the Bible. In fact, in Proverbs chapter 30, verse 6, it says, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. Write that verse down. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 6. And you'll see how religions love to make you feel good. Great. But they can't make you feel good enough to go to heaven unless they lie to you that their philosophy is what takes you to heaven. You can also write this down, this verse, Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. And it says, beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy, vain deceit, after the traditions of men and the philosophy of the world, and not after Christ. Now you read that in your Bible. God continually warns religions, denominations, and everything else will always add something to it, which cancels salvation. Eternal life is a free gift, bought and paid for. And I'll tell you what. Preacher came down to our house. Didn't want him there. Come in, sit down. Said, I can't stay long. I thought, oh, keep your word, buddy. You know, I didn't like preachers. And he knew that. He could sense that. And anyway, he just simply told us, you know what? Jesus Christ loved you so much, Max and Marge, and he paid for your sins. Your sins are completely paid for, and all you have to do to receive this free gift is believe that what God said concerning his son is true. God gave his only begotten son. He went to the cross. He suffered everything, crown of thorns jammed down on his head. If you look in, everybody knows Isaiah 53, but if you go to 52, the last four verses, you'll find out where the word marred means he was unrecognizable when they jammed this thorns down upon his head. I don't know if you ever got a thorn in your finger or not. Mm-hmm. You know, boy, that rascal hurts, doesn't it? And then you try to get it out and it breaks off right at the skin. So you've got the little point of it still down in your finger, and then you've got to get a needle and try to get that out of there and so forth. How would you like to have a whole crown of thorns jammed down upon your head? And the word marred in the Hebrew means unrecognizable. You couldn't recognize who he was. And then he said in Hebrews, he said, you know, it was a joy to go to the cross for you, because it's the only way that I can have you live with me in heaven is if I pay for your sins so you don't have to go to hell and do it yourself. Isn't it wonderful? Mm-hmm. I believe it is. So, anyway, we come to find out here that humanity had degraded so much, and we'll look here and read what God said about it, okay, in chapter 6 of Genesis, all right? Here we go. We find out here. He said in verse 1, and it came to pass when men began to multiply upon the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took to them wives of all which they chose. The Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. In other words, he just makes the statement, hadn't talked about the flood or anything yet. He just gives Moses the information and so forth. Okay, here we go. There were giants in the earth in those days and so forth. We come on down to verse 5, which I want to get to. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. It said, he repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping thing and the fowls of the air, and it repenteth me that I have made him. But Noah found grace. There's a reason. But I want to stop here and say why that we read that the Lord said, I'm going to destroy all mankind. It's hard to imagine, but if you take an honest analysis of society today, we have religions, there's so many you can't even keep up with them. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're popping up all over. We got a Hebrew guy that's starting Bible studies, and which I called, and to make a long story short, he wasn't there, his wife was, and I said, what verse do you use to lead people to Christ? She had no idea. And yet her husband teaches a Bible study and is supposed to teach you to use the Hebrew now for God and so forth there. And but anyway, she didn't even know a verse to how to go to heaven. And here this guy is. These are the kind of, I call them riffraffs that are all over, popping up everywhere and so forth. We come back here and we're going to find out here in verse 14 of the 6th chapter here what God said to do, because he's going to destroy all mankind now. So, it's very interesting. So he says here in verse 13, God said unto Noah, he said, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make thee an ark of gopher wood. Room shall thou make in the ark, and shall pitch it within and without with pitch. We'll come back to this because I want to get to the ark completed, and I want to give you some figures about what it could hold. Then we're going to come back and get to specifics, so I'm going to put the end before the beginning in this particular situation, all right? Make thee an ark of gopher wood, room shall thou make in the ark, and shall pitch it within and without with pitch. That was a sealer, like we seal boats up with in our boats if they leak and so forth. This is the fashion, and God says, I'm going to tell you how to make the boat, and here's the dimensions. It is interesting. Okay, in verse 15, the length of the ark shall be 300 cubits. A cubit is a foot and a half. That's the length of a cubit at that time, if you look in your dictionary and so forth like that. So, we find out that that would be 300 cubits, or, truthfully, about a football field and a half. Mm-hmm. That would be how long it was. 150 yards, about that, when you compute that down. And the breadth of it, 50 cubits. That's wide. And that would be 75 wide, and the height of it, 30. That would be 30, 18, and 15, 45 feet high. 45 feet high would be equivalent to how tall, really, would you say, downtown? Huh? Mm-hmm. That'd be quite high, wouldn't it? Move, say, a four-story building? I don't know, something like that, four- or five-story building. But the ark had three stories to it, so it would be plenty enough to cover that with a lot of room besides and so forth like that. And the breadth of it, so forth. And it'll have a window in it, one window. Thou shalt make to the ark and a cubit 18 inches, shalt thou finish it above, it shall be put above, and the door of the ark shalt thou set in the side thereof, and the lower second and third story shalt thou make it. So it had three stories. Now, to give you a little bit of information concerning this, I would like to point this out to you if I could do this. You'll find out with that, that it had a lot of square feet and so forth here. The size of the ark would be 450 feet by 75 feet and by 45 feet. Other words, each of the three floors had 33,750 square feet. That was for each floor. We find out 101,250 square feet was the total for all three floors in the ark. And then the cubic feet was 1,518,750 cubic feet. Now you come down and say, that's pretty good size. Yes, that's pretty good size, all right. But how are they going to get all the animals on there and so forth? And how did they all get into the ark? Well, we're going to see something here, and while we're here, how would Noah get them in? Let's go back here to chapter 6, verse 20, and chapter 7, verse 15. Chapter 6, verse 20 says this, of the fowls after their kind, and so forth. Now in verse 19, of every living thing, of all flesh, two of every sort shall thou bring into the ark to keep them alive with thee. They shall be male and female. Of the fowls of their kind, and of the cattle of their kind, every creeping thing of the earth, and after their kind, two of every sort shall come unto thee to keep them alive. Now you say, how in the world? And this has come up, I've had this with college professors and so forth, and come up and say, how in the world is Noah going to get good night? Deer run from you today. No, if they hear me one twig crack, they're off and gone. Well, I made them that way. But you know, it wasn't so up until then, because there was no meat diet. They were strictly vegetarians for 1,656 years. Isn't that something? 1,656 years. There was no meat diet whatsoever. They were to eat of the vegetables and the things of the earth. You'll find that in Genesis chapter 1, chapter 2. You'll find that. And then the meat diet was not included, so the animals were not scared of man whatsoever. In fact, in the millennial reign, it will be as it was clear back in creation time, when there will not be the eating of the animals again, because they'll have the peace of that. There will not be coyotes eating deer and stuff like that. That's all going to change in the millennial reign. There will be perfect peace, even in the animal kingdom. Time will take a little more time to go into some of those verses and show you that. It's in Romans also, and there. But we find out in chapter 9 of Genesis here where the meat diet was included. Okay? So, we find out there, they shall come unto thee to keep them alive. And thou shalt take unto thee of all food that is eaten, and thou shalt gather it to thee, and it shall be for food for thee and for them. you're going to gather the food for them. But they'll come. They probably come to see, hey, what's going on here? What the way you nailed these boards together here, making a boat and everything else like that? You must remember this. The ark was in a small scale like this is here. It was on a much larger scale. It was rectangular, and it did not have a bow. It was square in the front, it was square in the back, and it was never made to sail. It was made to float. That's all that it was, to preserve. There were no oars in it. There was no Evinrude motors. There was no Johnson motors. No motors at all. There was no way to move the ark whatsoever. They were in the ark, and God did the moving. Well, that's interesting, isn't it? When that took place like there, Noah, who knew it hadn't rained in 1656 years, that took a little bit of faith, didn't it? It most assuredly did. Now, it had never rained before on the face of the earth. Isn't that interesting? Never rained before, not one drop. The earth was watered by the dew that come up from the ground and so forth like that with the vegetation and so forth. Never one drop of rain came from heaven to earth. So, can you imagine all of these people that are worshiping false gods and everything else, their self-righteousness and everything, they were corrupt in their morals and everything else? Can you imagine? And here comes Noah, and he's saying, hey, we got 120 years here, and it's going to take me to build this ark, and he's going to be preaching. Oh, my goodness gracious. Where did this nut come from? Hey, we're getting along just fine down here upon the earth here. Everybody's happy and everybody's doing this and that. And we want five wives, we can have them in one thing or another. It doesn't, morality is nothing. And if you don't like somebody and you want to kill them, go ahead. Nobody, you're not going to court. There's no Supreme Court. You can get away with it if you sneak around, do it good enough, and so forth. Everything, they were wicked from the top to the bottom. God knew every one of their minds, just like he knows your mind. He knows my mind, your mind. There isn't one thing that escapes the mind of God. He knows what you're thinking the minute it comes into your mind. He's omniscient. He knows everything. Everything. Now, knowing that, we find out that he said here concerning that. He said, you know, he said, you build the ark, Noah, 300 years, my spirit shall not always, and I want to tell you what the Pentecostals do with this. I just want you to look at this one more time. In chapter 6, verse 3, the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for he is yet flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. Nothing's going to happen for 120 years. You preach, you tell him, Noah. And he was labeled as the biggest misfit there ever was. What do you mean, this guy coming on here telling me that there's going to be a flood? It hasn't rained from heaven since we've been here, since we've been born. What do you tell him? And he's going to drown us all? Hey, we're pretty good people. Well, God wouldn't do that, you know? So, he says here, my spirit shall not always strive. You know what Pentecostals do with that verse? They take that out and say, there'll come a time in your life when God will not strive with you one more time. Of course, they don't say anything about 120 years. They just pull that little verse out and try to scare you in that if you don't accept Christ this morning, then the striving of the Holy Spirit will not at all strive with you again, and you're lost on your way to hell. Well, we forget the fact that when you preach the word next Sunday, he could be saved next Sunday, couldn't he? If he hears the word again, and the Holy Spirit convicts, and the word of God is what convicts. But this preacher said the Sunday before, oh, the Holy Spirit is not going to strive with you forever. I want to tell you something. I've led quite a few people to the Lord on their deathbed, and they died the next day. That's happened. And you mean to tell me the Spirit is not? But this is how religion takes one verse, cuts a little piece out of it, and tries to scare you in. If you don't get saved this morning, well, the Spirit probably won't strive with you anymore. I mean, he's sick and tired of you saying no to him. No. I'll tell you what, I found out that some of the hardest men that have rejected the Lord, like they say, there's no atheists in foxholes. When it comes down to dying, everything changes, folks, and a lot of people. It really does. But let's go on here and look at some other things here also, okay? We come on down And I want to take you back to the little book of Jude, because prior to Noah, there was another man by the name of Enoch who also warned them. We go back here. Now, the little book of Jude is right before the last book of the Bible, Revelation. And God describes here, we have Jude write this here by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. I want you to tell people, when they read my word here, this is my word to them, all right? Now, we come here, and I'm going to lay you a little background. He's talking about in verse 10 here, the little book of Jude, okay? But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts. In other words, they don't know any more than what an animal does. They go by instinct, they go by what they heard on the street corner, they go by this, they go by that. They're absolutely stupid people. In those things they corrupt themselves, but they present to you how smart they are. Woe to them, for they have gone the way of Cain. How did Cain go? He wanted to go to heaven by his good works, didn't he? Isn't that what he went? He killed Abel, didn't he? God uses him as an example. They hate the gospel. They hate the blood of Christ. They hate the blood that was shed. And they just want to have their own way and do what they want to do. They ran greedily after the heir of Balaam for reward and perished at gainsaying of Korah. I have from a Christian organization down in Florida, and they are attorneys that represent Christians free of all the things. I have a whole list of different things that they represent and so forth, that if you have a job and you're not a Christian, your chances of getting along better, in most cases, not all cases, are much better. Because you're going to drink with the boss and with the guys and the gang and so forth. You're going to get along in society in one thing or another, and you're going to do all right. But if you take a stand and say, no, I just don't want to do that, you're not criticizing them. You just have a right to make your own decision, right? So if you're doing something, they're doing something that you don't want to do, and you know God doesn't want you to do it, you say no to it. The person who goes along with him is going to get promoted most generally before the person who disagrees with the boss. Big factories, jobs, construction jobs and sites, and so forth, you'll find that to be true. So, these are spots in your feast of charity. When they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds they are without water. Clouds not much good, it doesn't have water, does it? That's how God uses it to carry. About of the winds, trees whose fruit thereof without fruit, they're twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Twice dead means they're as good as dead, because the wages of sin is death, that's physical death. Twice dead is, depart from me, you're cursed into the everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. That's your spiritual death in hell for all time and eternity. So they're twice dead. And then he goes on, raging waves of the sea, foaming out of their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. And, get this in verse 14. Now he reverts back clear before the flood. He says, and Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, here Enoch, what has taken place here at the time of Jude, when he's right here warning people about it, how you got these counterfeits that'll do, they'll eat with you, and they'll use God's name in vain and everything else, and it's just as common as can be, you know? And he literally refers back, they did this, clear back before the flood. That's why God said the imaginations of the minds were evil continually, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. That's what Enoch preached before Noah came on with the instructions to build the ark. And he preached that. He said, the Lord will come with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon you misfits. You laugh at this and you laugh at that, and you think you can go around and commit all kinds of sins you want to do and have your own way, and you think there is no God in one thing or another. He said, and Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, of all of their hard speeches, and which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Don't you just love these? And now, I'll just tell you my own thing, and we relate this once in a while to you. I love to get a hold of the atheist. It doesn't bother me a bit. I go, went up to South Coast State University about 4 or 5 years ago, and got to talk with, and I forget which one I asked for now, if it was the professor of geology or professor of science, I can't remember now, but I met with him for quite a while. And I went with him under the auspices of, do you have any more information on carbon 14? So, and I talked to him, and I said, you know, we're getting this garbage going around about a young Earth. Yeah, he said, that's the biggest joke it ever was. And you're going to find out, people that know something don't buy this at all. But anyway, I said, you know what? I agree with you because there is no young Earth. Now, there's a young creation, but not a young Earth. And I said, do you know that the Earth could be millions of years old? Yeah. He said, we know. We don't know how many millions are there, but we know it's older than this 6,000 years stuff that you're trying to give us. I said, well, exclude me because I'm not trying to give to it, and I refute that. The Bible doesn't teach that. You got the con men out here that do that. And you got preachers that follow these con men and so forth. But I'm just telling you, it isn't true, sir. That opened the door in order for me to witness to him. Now, he did not trust the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior, but he knew how to go to heaven because I told him. And I said, I hope you'll consider that and give him some salvation verses like Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, and so forth like that. There. But, you know what? These things are rejected by people who know better than that, by true science, not science falsely so-called, as Timothy talked about. You got to look at this. Scientists don't even believe other scientists. There's as much conflict into that as if you start reading about this scientist said this, this scientist said that, and this and here. They wouldn't have to change their textbooks every 4 or 5 years if what they said was right to begin with. And that's what they have to do, you know. The Bible has never changed because what God said is true. It's not up for guesswork. It's not up to be changed. It's not up to be added to. And here we find out all of this. Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these saying, behold, the Lord cometh through 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment. And he's saying, just as what he preached, how true that really is, and so forth. Now, you come back here to Genesis chapter 5, verse 22. We're back here in Genesis chapter 5, verse 22. All right? Genesis chapter 5, verse 22, and God tells about Eden. Okay? Chapter 5, look in verse 22. It says here in verse 21, and Enoch lived 605 years and begot Methuselah. Well, that's interesting because the word Methuselah in the Hebrew means when he dies, judgment shall come. The flood came the same year he died. Isn't that amazing? God puts all kinds of things in here, doesn't he? He says, and Enoch lived 65 years, begot Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begot Methuselah 300 years and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Now, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Now, it's a very interesting thing here, that if you notice in verse 22, God makes it very clear that Enoch believed in God. He most assuredly did, and he was not one that was going to go to hell. Notice what it says in verse 22, and he says it again on down here in verse 24. Enoch walked with God. Now we come here in verse 24, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Does that mean he was raptured home? No. It means he didn't die in his physical body naturally. But we find out that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So what did God do? He just changed like he would have been changed, and you're going to be changed at the rapture. You're not going to have to die a physical death and go through the funeral home and so forth. You're going to be changed in a moment and a twinkling of an eye, and this body is going to be changed into a new body where there will never be sickness, sorrow, or death again. The same with Enoch here. He didn't go and get cancer and get this and have a stroke and all of that. He didn't die a natural death the way the body dies. God just plain took him out of that body there and put him right into paradise. So he was not. He didn't have to die a physical death, but he had to put off the physical body, and God just took him and put him into paradise therefore, because he walked with God. And he said twice, he said it twice. Very interesting. Only two verses away. He said in verse 20, he walked with God. Come down to verse 24 after he tells about how long he was here upon the earth. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. God was displeased, didn't want him to die the natural death, and he took him, which could become a type of what will take place when the rapture comes. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Us which alive remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the clouds. So shall we ever be with the Lord. And you're living in a dispensation of time when the rapture is very, very close, because there's nothing in Bible prophecy to be fulfilled until the Lord comes. Nothing. You're seeing about Russia. We had a letter from, or an email from a man, and everybody was so excited about, well, what about, you know, Russia going on in to taking the other part of the country there now? Well, they had a man on there here, I believe it was last night we seen this. He had this big map up there and so forth. He was very good. Well, we took this little one, country here, and it has a seaport. Of course Russia wants that, because they can reach any part of the world and so forth there. But the other up there, with Ukraine, that up there, they want that too, and they're going to take it. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you don't know this, Obama is looked on as the liar of the world, nothing but a big mouth, no substance behind it, and he's laughed at almost all over the world. Now, if you don't know that, Putin knows that, and he called him just the other night. I can't imagine, didn't say what he said, but I'm just going to imagine. Hey, Obama, we're going on up and take this up here, do what you want to about it, but that's our country, and we have a legal right to do it and give all the things about why they have a right to do it and so forth. What's Obama going to do? Yeah, well, he's going to increase the sanctions a little bit more. Putin laughs at this guy. It is the worst we've ever had as a president of the United States. One lie after another lie after another lie after another lie after another lie. We're living in a generation where this man doesn't even know the truth. He knows how to con you, but he doesn't know the truth.
Right.
And to make a long story short, the fellow was interested. Oh, Russia's advancing. Forget about what even Russia does. If he takes over three more countries, it doesn't make any difference. God said when Russia would be destroyed, and he will not, that country, along with Persia, along with Ethiopia, along with Iran, which was old Persia and so forth, Germany and that, and Turkey, all of these are with Russia, and God says, you will not be destroyed. I will destroy you. Some of these Bible scholars hunting, oh, we got all these missiles and all that. Put them in the garbage can part, because this is God's battle with Russia, who is anti-God, anti-Christian, and everything else, led millions to hell, that God will take care of him, and he doesn't need your missiles to do it with. He will destroy that. As Gog and Magog, when God destroys everyone that comes against him at the end of the millennial reign of Christ. But when Russia comes down after the rapture, Russia even defiles the Antichrist and takes his army along with these five allies, and they come down and they go over and come down on horseback and come down against Israel. God causes a rain to come. That causes them a lot of trouble, because even horses, when you have a torrential rain, and God says, after this little rain here, I'm going to pour it down from heaven like the heaven broke open, and you're going to be flooded to the point they start killing themselves, and God destroys them all. Russia will not be destroyed until after the rapture. Mark that down. So it doesn't matter to me what Russia does. Do what you want to do. It doesn't make any difference. Your time is predicted by God when you're going to be destroyed, and you will not be destroyed before that. That's very interesting, isn't it? Israel, you're not going to be destroyed before that, because you have to be alive after the rapture to make a covenant with the Antichrist. That's prophecy. You can take that to the bank. So, the big mistake that people and mankind and some of these so-called Bible scholars do, every time something happens, they try to fit it into prophecy. You can't do that. We seen a program the other night, and they couldn't figure out in the book of Revelation about these earthquakes and that. Well, this happened before. Oh yeah, it happened all over before. This earthquake, there's nothing like it. It hasn't happened before. And when you violate a basic principle, life, and I want to give this to you real fast, and I want to go on here and get to some things I want to give to you here real fast. First of all, there's a natural outline in Revelation chapter 1. God said, John, write, give the natural outline, write the things thou hast seen. That's glorified Christ and Him crucified. Write the things which are, that's existing now, chapters 2 and 3, the seven churches. Write the things which shall be hereafter. And chapter 4 talks about the taking up, and we find out that you don't find the church from there on. Everything from chapter 4 on has never been fulfilled yet. Never. So what you read in the book of Revelation, start with chapter 5. Everything from there on is yet future. When you do away with the foundation of the outline that God gives, you are screwed up royal. And these idiots are up there standing, well, we can't say for sure if what happened back there when they had the earthquake with Korah and so forth, did that fulfill Revelation? Sir, you idiots. You don't know any more about Bible interpretation or Bible discernment when God gave you an outline and none of you follow it. Now, all the old Bible scholars before had it right down right. Cameron had it down. Tennessee Temple Schools, Dr. Lee Robinson, they had it down. I mean, it was all over. They had it right. They faded off of the scene, and you're getting nothing but a bunch of garbage with some exceptions. Now, let me give this to you because I want to give it here before I run out of time. And maybe we'll see if we'll get time to go on back, but I doubt if we will. First of all, what's the volume of the ark? We figured this out, a capacity equal to 522 standard stock cars or 8 freight trains with 65 cars each could hold all the animals. First of all, they didn't take all of the animals. They only took a species of them, you see. And we find out they took 7s, they were to be offered sacrifice, they were to be eaten, and 2 of the unclean, and they were to be and keep the earth clean. Thank God for the birds and stuff that eat the flesh of the dead animals, isn't that right? Isn't it good? Yeah, well, you'd be flooded whether we didn't have some hawks and eagles and even crows and so forth like that to eat some of the dead animals that are out here. And so God made them that way. You're not to eat those animals at all. You're not to eat wolves. In fact, there's a whole list of animals and bugs and things that you're not to eat, including chocolate-covered ants. And I seen them in a store one time. I seen them in a store. I couldn't believe what I was looking. I went back to my Bible and I started looking here. No, you're not to eat ants. Ants are not to be eaten, so forth. But it lists a whole bunch of things in the Pentateuch there, and Deuteronomy and so forth. Another thing, cattle are about 25 to a stock car, hogs about 25 in a double-deck car, and sheep about 250 in a double-deck car. Give you an idea of what that could haul. 2 trains hauling 73 cars each could carry about 35,000 animals. Now you got to remember, they're only taking one species of each one. Your dogs and everything came from one species down through the years. There's been, I think, 300 different species of dogs just probably within the last, 100 years. I may have that a little too long or maybe a little shorter. But all these different species of dogs. And they have, like, the Eohippus horse. The Eohippus horse is what scientists like to flow in your face. Oh, it's just a little dog. He's smaller than a St. Bernard. He's a horse. But he's a horse. So they try to say, oh, he evolved up into a giant Clydesdale. Really? Really? You ignoramuses here with your false science falsely so-called, to try to deceive them. Behind every false teaching is one person. That person's name is Satan. He's a murderer, and he is a liar. He will try to get you into hell any way he possibly can, and he'll try to get you connected with a church that'll take you there. By their sacrifices, by their good works, by their self-righteousness, by their baptism, or what else it might be, church membership, giving your money to God, worshiping God, and so forth. And there, a man told me this morning, he's in church today, they went to a funeral, a Catholic funeral, there were three things that you needed to do and why this man was saved. He was a farmer.
Family.
His family, good to his family.
And faith.
And faith. And that's why he's in heaven. Really? Well, everybody's not a farmer then. He's only two-thirds. He'll make it to the clouds, but he won't make it all the way up. You know, if you're going to have those three things. I'm not a farmer. You know, I have trouble probably even growing a garden, you know. But anyway, so much for that. Let's go on. I want to finish this up. The carrying capacity of the ark was equivalent to that of 522 stock cars of this size, with no problem carrying the original species. Concerning the space occupied by worms and insects and small similar creatures, it's interesting to note that if each averaged 2 inches on the side, only 21 more cars would be sufficed to handle over 1 million individuals. Over 500 varieties of the sweet pea have been developed from a single type since the year 1700. Over 200 distinct varieties of dogs have been developed from a very few wild dogs. They did not take the largest of each species, but rather the smallest. What's the matter with that? And another thing, how in the world did these animals come across all these oceans? The earth wasn't divided yet. You will find out in Genesis, and I'd like for you to look here. Go to chapter 10, if you will, in verse 28. Chapter 10, verse 28. The earth was all together in one land mass, and all the water and the oceans, one ocean, everything was connected. There were no oceans separating the continents. And Arphaxad begot Selah, and Selah begot Eber, and unto Eber were born two sons. The name of the one was Peleg, for in his days was the earth divided, and his brother's name was Joktan. Now in his days, so we did a research on the genealogies. Now that's very interesting. He was born 101 years after the flood, and he died 340 years after the flood. So somewhere between 101 years after the flood up until 340 years was the earth divided. That's as close as we can get. So the animals and things didn't have to cross any seas, any oceans, or anything else. They were not in Africa. Africa wasn't Africa yet. They were all together. Years ago, I think it was about 1967, I have a copy given out by Scientific America that showed that all of the Earth continents were at one time together. Isn't that amazing? They didn't have to. The animals came. They didn't have to cross anything. They might have had to step over a stream somewhere, but they didn't have any oceans. There was no Indian Ocean. There was no Pacific Ocean. There was no Atlantic Ocean. There was no Baltic Sea. There was no nothing like that. All the Earth was together. And then, I'd like for you to, and that's a good time to stop here, I'd like for you to go with me to chapter 9 now, okay? Chapter 9 in the book of Genesis. Isn't this Genesis so interesting?
Yeah.
Really? You don't hear this much over the radio, do you? You don't hear it much over by preachers much.
No.
It used to be preached all the time. This is how it's disintegrated from teaching any more of the Bible and so forth. We come to chapter 9, all right? Now, we find out that if you go back to, just hold your place in Genesis chapter 9, okay? If you will there. And we go back here and find out here in Genesis chapter 1. I just want to read this. You don't have to go there. You can read it yourself here. Where it says, "And God, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree in which is fruit, and of a tree yielding seed, and to you it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. They were vegetarians. Every herb for meat. That is, every green thing was given to them. They did not eat each other. Now, go with me to Genesis chapter 9. This is after the flood now. That's why they came on. They had no fear of man. Man didn't kill them or anything else. But now after the flood, here's what we find. Notice in verse 1, God blessed Noah and his sons, said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth. Why? We're going to see. And upon every fowl of the air, and upon all that moveth upon the earth, upon all the fishes of the sea, into your hand are they delivered. That's if you use the right kind of bait. You know, in other words, you can eat them. You know, they don't come say, fishy, fishy, get in my bucket. And they get out there and line up and say, we got a little bit to the right, a little bit to the left. Now let's get back, get a little swim, and we're going to go. We'll hit it right in the bucket there, and they can eat us. I don't think it works that way, do you? I mean, we use the best bait that we can use and sit there half a day and don't even get a bite. I think you dumb fish. But they're not dumb. They got pretty good on what to eat and what not to eat there, you know. Now we come on down here. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you. Now you can kill them. Even as the green herb have I given you all things, but flesh of the life there is in the blood thereof shall you not eat. So you can't eat that. But anyway, this is a good place to stop here. We'll be right on time there. The important thing is, I just want to bring out a few things like this. Just go to show you how precise God is, and so forth. And I might say this. I can do this without turning to it. I will turn to it. This one more. Do this really, really fast. Show you how precise God is. Okay? Let's go back here. Here we go. In chapter 8, okay? Here we go. We find out here, and the ark rested in the seventh month on the 17th day of the month upon the mountains of Ararat. Let me just illustrate this. Seventh month, 17th day. This was the calendar at the time up until Israel was freed from Egypt. This was the calendar that was used. When you research this, the 10th month of this secular calendar was the first month of the secular year. Now that may seem a little confusing, but I'm going to show you something. So we take the 10th month. When it came out of Egypt there, he said, I'm giving you a spiritual religious calendar, and it shall be at the Passover, will be on the 17th day, the 14th day, Christ was crucified, 17th day, he rose from the dead, and we find out it will be on the 4th month, which will be April. In the Hebrew, it's Nisan or Abib. Both of them are used there, the names. But it will be in April, and it will be on the 15th for Passover. Resurrection will be on the 17th, resurrected 3 days later. Follow with me what I'm telling you. Since the secular calendar, the first month of the secular year, happened to be the month of October, the 10th month. Okay? So, we take October, November, December, January, February, March, April, which is the seventh month, is the April that's going to be in the future when he gives the religious calendar unto the nation of Israel. Since the ark here is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ, isn't it amazing that it traveled some hundreds of miles and rested on the mountains of Ararat on the 17th day, the same day Christ arose from the dead? Is that by accident?
No.
How did God know to pick up all the numbers in the world and say the ark rested upon the 17th day? Because it was resurrected above the judgment that God put upon the earth. When they crucified Christ upon the earth, on the 14th day of Passover, the 17th day, which the ark represents, he is the ark of our salvation, that 17th day, was when he rose above, what man could put him to death and keep him there? And he was resurrected. He paid for our sins by his resurrected. Being resurrected, there wasn't one sin that was left unpaid, or he would have been left in the grave. When he rose from the dead, he paid for all sins that would ever be committed by every human being. He paid the eternal punishment of that sin, so that he offers that heavenly, I should say, gift that he bought and paid for on the cross. And everything in the Old Testament points to the Lord Jesus Christ, including the Ark of the Covenant, which was, and I could go in, but our time's gone. But the Ark there of the Covenant and so forth, you will find out on the 14th day, the 17th day, he rose from the dead, the same time which the Ark is a type of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and he puts the date down so that you would have no question. God knows what he's talking about hundreds of years before it ever happens. And he picked the right date of resurrection of the Ark on there, representing Christ when he rose from the dead. And you wonder about this Bible being true? Only the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Okay, closing. Right on time, what did I do, my billfold? You didn't put my billfold in, Marge. I don't have a billfold. No, I mean, if you got a billfold, you didn't have a billfold either. Okay, well, we'll do it this way then. I know why they're afraid to take money out of it. That's what I'm just kidding you. But you know what? The greatest thing is this. God loved me. I'm so glad about that. There's nobody ever loved you, even your parents, like Jesus Christ. He had the glories of heaven. He came down from heaven because God said, I'm giving my only begotten Son, because he's going to take on human flesh. And he's going to be identified as the Son of God. And he came down with a perfect body because God took the Holy Spirit and substituted the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, to do what the sperm of the man would do when it fertilized the egg. But we couldn't do that, or we'd have a nature born with a sinful nature just like we are. So God had to get the man out of there with his sperm, and the Holy Spirit would make that conception, but it would be with a perfect God Father, God Son, and God Holy Spirit. She became pregnant by putting her, giving her part to give the body to the Lord Jesus, but a body that was not contaminated with her blood, because she cannot produce blood for the baby without the sperm properties fertilizing the egg. She does not have the properties without the sperm fertilizing the egg to make blood for the baby. The Holy Spirit did that. I found no fault in him, Pilate said. Being sinless, he could go to the cross, pay for my sin, and therefore guarantee that I would have eternal life. What a wonderful Savior we have. Isn't it wonderful to be a Christian? Absolutely. So let's just bow over to prayer. You are. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you for these simple things. We can understand why you put the numbers in the Bible. We can understand why you put the genealogies, because you let us know that, well, if the earth's going to be divided in the days of Peleg, then how long was he on here? What year was he born in? What year did he die in? Well, you put it in the Bible. It's from 101 on up there to 300 and some, when he died, and the earth was divided after that. Prior to that, it was never divided. It was one unit. What a wonderful revelation that you've given to mankind to answer just about any question he would ever want. Thank you for that and answering the question that I believe, dear Lord, that you love a sinner like me, and you came from heaven to earth to pay for my sins, because you love me so much that when you created me, you wanted me to live with you in heaven for all time and eternity, as you do anyone who will just accept the free ticket to heaven by believing that you paid for their sins. Bless each one here. Give us a good day in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.